my part, which I hope will be livelier, and because I have all the pictures, I was thinking of how to talk about these elections, and I realized that, you know, we all know the numbers, but I need to bring a little bit more of insider anecdotes to give you the real sense of how things go in Ukraine. So let me start by showing you the polls. Now, for almost all the campaign period, these people, and as political frontrunners, have been considered to be the winners of this parliamentary election campaign. Although the numbers differed, we all understood that Medvedchuk, Lovochkin, and the kind of Fifteshov's party will come second, Poroshenko third, and then the Vakarchuk and Timoshenko will share the fourth and fifth place. However, something very unexpected happened yesterday with the International Institute of Sociology. All of a sudden, given Zelensky a little bit higher rating, and showing that Vakarchuk will not even make the 5% threshold, instead Smishko is coming into his place. I will try to explain this sudden change because it is a little bit peculiar, you know, that a few days, just a couple of days before the vote, all of a sudden we have this change in the dynamic. And knowing how elections are being made in Ukraine, I suspect that the people in power who control what Sergei has called the grid and the composition of electoral committee will try to make sure that Vakarchuk doesn't make it into the parliament, simply because he represents, among all these political forces who currently run, a real challenge to the system. Although he could make a very small fraction in the Rada, but still he's someone whom oligarchs cannot fully control. Whereas the Smishko's party is a direct opposite to that. It is most fully made of people close to Poroshenko and some other oligarchs. So maybe the system has decided that it would be much easier for Zelensky and for their political future to have Smishko in power instead of Vakarchuk, who has pretty good chances of growing eventually into a national level politician. The size of letters here is small, but all I wanted to show you the ratings of Ukrainian strategy. It is almost the last line here, led by Groysman. Many people hope that Groysman will, you know, in accordance with Ukraine's legislation, if a political party makes at least 2% in this election, the party is becomes eligible to state funding. So with 2% of a vote, you can be kind of receiving a substantial and sustained funding throughout the next 5 years, which gives you a better chances of running for and local elections, which are next year. And that is why Groysman, as a politician, who is also a very young politician, only 41 years old, can be seen as someone whose career is not yet over, a political figure to watch. Some people laughed in Ukraine about this Lugana Roda, servant of the people, kind of brand. People in Vladimir Petrovich's circle, who are historians, they have found this Soviet era, actually the Stalin era cartoon, which is also related to elections to the Supreme Soviet. Which argued the deputy has to be the Sluga Naroda, and they claim that, you know, ideologically, Zelensky and his people are still mentally in the past, because, you know, with this old symbols, you know, they somehow demonstrate that they're not as innovative as that they claim to be, but it is something that is deeply rooted in people's Soviet mentality. Vladimir Petrovich. By the way, I don't know if that is true, they claim that the last name of the person who made this cartoon is also Zelensky. So, on this slide, I show you the photograph from the Zelensky's party congress, you know, which was also organized, I could say, almost spontaneously. There are a lot of rumors whether the people in his entourage and Kolomoisky personally were in favor of the pre-term election, or whether it was his spontaneous decision. I've heard rumors that Kolomoisky was actually the one who talked him against these elections. But it is very symbolic if you look at who is next to him. And I have other slides to kind of to demonstrate that Zelensky is actually truly surrounds himself with very trusted individuals. And although during his presidential election campaign he promised that there would be no patron clientelism within his administration, that there will be no favoritism, he still does not fully yet represent the new approach to appointment of chief executives in his administration, in regional governments, etc. And on this quarter we see his former chief of Quartal 95, Mr. Shafir, who was born in Kryvyi Rih, just as Zelensky, and who has been his business partner from day one. We see Andriy Bogdan, who is now chief of his presidential secretariat. As you know, the name of this administration was changed because Bogdan could be lustrated in accordance with Ukraine's legislation. Officially, he cannot even hold a governmental position in Ukraine. But to bypass this rule, he, as a lawyer, came up with an innovative approach. He said, if I can be lustrated, then let us just change the name of the institution I work for. So that is why it is no longer the presidential administration, it is the presidential secretariat. And the head of Kolomoisky's TV channel 1+1, which is, of course, a business partner to Zelensky, and which basically made Zelensky's presidential campaign, because, as you know, Servants of the People sequel and his Kvartal 95 stand-up shows were run almost 24 hours a day on Kolomoisky's TV channel.
Alexander Tkachenko.
Alexander Tkachenko, who also runs on his list. And although I will talk later about it. Unfortunately, you can't see this, is a little bit dark. Can we, someone turned on the, use, made this a little bit dark, so some photographs might not be useful. So here we see several, again, the same faces. So Shafir is sitting
in the middle. Okay, can you sort of tell us where they are, who's sitting where?
Who is sitting? So next to Zelensky, and that is the day when they celebrate Ukraine's Constitution Day in July. He proudly displays this photograph on his Facebook page. So across him, you know, the guy at the this one. So this is Andriy Bogdan, this is Shafir, the other guy is Mr. Kirilenko, who is, Kirill Tymoshenko, who is also producer of a company, former producer of a company.
So who is Kirill Tymoshenko?
No, Kirill Tymoshenko is the guy in the blue shirt sitting left to Zelensky.
Okay.
Yes, so he's a former producer of the company called Film UA, again a business partner to Zelensky, who made the a lot of work with him before. So Shafir, then his aide Andriy Yermak, Yuri Kostyuk is in the man in green shirt, the former producer of Servant of the People movie. So you see that basically these are Kvartal 95 people, and just Bogdan is kind of an outsider to Kvartal 95, but he is Kolomoisky's lawyer, and he is also linked to several other wealthy people and also oligarchs in Ukraine whose interests he represented. There were a lot of rumors about how many people actually helped, so to say, Zelensky with the political list that they produced. Big was in for it is an investigative journalist group have hacked some emails of his official campaign manager, Mr. Sergei Trofimov, who is also deputy head of presidential administration. Not much is known about Trofimov. You cannot find his official bio. You cannot find his videos on YouTube. But we know that he's also a former producer of Kvartal 95. And now he's responsible as the first deputy of the administration for regional appointments, appointments of rayon administration. And he was the one who kind of was taking different names from different individuals who were coming with suggestions who should be nominated. So officially, the campaign is run by the person named Alexander Kornienko. He is number 7 on the campaign list. party list. Kremlin claimed in one of his interviews that they received more than 3,500 applications which have been sent to them online. But knowing the insider process a little bit, I would say that, you know, I just wonder if any of those 3,500 eventually got on the list, because people do not come and are not put on the list spontaneously. You know, someone has recommended them and someone was behind them. So who were those groups which were behind the people who finally got on the list? So those had emails that Vigus Info has demonstrated. They identified four groups of influence. The first group was called Dada, or the uncle, and by Dada they meant Andrei Bogdan, chief of presidential secretariat. The second group was called Nizhnye, after the last name of Sergei Nizhny. He's a lawyer of Kvartal 95, and he was also bringing, coming up with some names. The third group was called Regions, and it was led by Ilya Pavlyuk, another regional advisor to Zelensky's campaign. And the last group was called Kvartal, it's understood, Kvartal 95, and it was led by Boris Shafir, who is now advisor to Zelensky. Yesterday, Brian Mefford, who is a long-term watcher of Ukrainian politics, has published his piece on elections, where he claims that after elections, Sila Lipday will get at least 120 seats who would be elected based on the party list system. They can make at least 100 people elected in the single mandate constituencies, but still, with 220 votes, they won't be able to form a majority just by themselves. They will need to partner with someone. Medvedchuk, with his current political ratings and high popularity in the east of Ukraine, can get as much as 60 seats, which will eventually make him eligible for the post of the first deputy Rada speaker, which in my opinion would be a very big problem for Ukraine, because the number of the position to Ukraine's European integration and Euro-Atlantic integration is getting much stronger. Poroshenko will have only 50 votes, which is a dramatic decrease compared to what he had in the past of 130 seats. Tymoshenko will be in the margins with only 30 members. And again, it is unclear whether Vakarchuk or Smishko will come last with at least 40 seats. But how can we explain, yes, and this is a very interesting slide. You know, the Ukrainian media has caught Bogdan speaking and whispering something into Zelensky's ear. And if you remember, when Kurt Volker and the US delegation came to Ukraine immediately after presidential elections, Kurt Volker strongly recommended to Zelensky not to appoint Bogdan as his chief of administration, and nevertheless Zelensky did appoint him, and many people wondered, like, how could that happen. I read an interesting piece by Yulia Mostova, you know, one of the best Ukraine's political analysts and political journals, where she claimed that Bogdan cannot be seen as Kolomoisky's man only, and that Zelensky needs him just as President Yeltsin needed his press secretary Kostelyov, who was able to translate his drunken language into Russian. So for Zelensky, Bogdan is this type of a person, because Zelensky, as we know, his rhetoric is very poor. Sometimes he cannot express himself fully. So when he has an idea but cannot, you know, explain to the people in the room what he actually means, then Bogdan jumps in, whom she characterized as a very innovative, very creative, very straightforward person. And maybe Zelensky needs him not only because he is a great lawyer who knows the system, but because he simply trusts his abilities to kind of, because they have good chemistry and they can work together well. I love those slides from the Polish press. You know, the Poles have a particular, peculiar sense of humor. On this slide they say, Zrob sobie Zelenskiego. You can make yourself your own, you can make your own Zelensky to yourself. And there is a lot of truth to this image, because
this is,
Because, you know, as you remember, Zelensky will probably go into history as the first presidential candidate and the first president who was elected without giving a single open press conference to journalists. And because his views were absolutely unclear, people could guess, you know, whether he is indeed a pro-Russia politician, whether he is pro-NATO politician, what he thinks really about corruption, what kind of a healthcare reform he wants to implement, what are his thoughts about Ukraine's humanitarian policy. Like, we just had this hologram, you know, of Zelensky, the actor, Halabarotka, and actually the electorate really could identify him with anything, just fantasize and dream, and almost put your own expectations into the candidate about whom you know very, very little. And the same continues now with this election campaign, because people on his electoral ticket are exactly the same type of Halabarotkas, people we know very little about, and because we know so little about them, it is very difficult to criticize these people, because they haven't done anything political yet, and that is why his list is like a white sheet of paper on which you can write anything you want. And of course, the funny image of Kolomoisky about the true president of Ukraine. Well, the last decisions that Ukraine's court are taking these days about taking, which are all in favor of Kolomoisky's companies, indeed indicate that things have changed and that Kolomoisky may indeed stand behind a lot of political and economic processes in Ukraine. On this slide, I show you what kind of reform the Ukrainian electorate expected from the president and from the parliament after it had been elected. And the anti-corruption reform is number one on this list, with 63% of people really looking forward for real breakthroughs in the area of anti-corruption. That is why Zelensky very smartly and also Vakarchuk with his Volos party, they put one of the most prominent Ukraine's anti-corruption activists in the top 10 of the electoral tickets. For example, in Zelensky's party, we have number 5, Galina Yanchenko, who used to work with the Center of Combating Corruption. The more interesting element of her bio is that she is a wife of Viktor Andrusiev, who is a director of the Ukrainian Institute for the Future. It is a think tank which is linked to Avakov and Anton Gerashenko. Interestingly, this institute is founded by an expert, Anatoly Amelin, and Anatoly Amelin's wife runs as number 2 on Smishko's list. Her name, she's a former MP from Samopomich. Lena Sotnik. So number 8 is, and I will come back to this because I think it is important to see how these wealthy and powerful people in Ukraine put their associates into different lists, which may indeed indicate, you know, how they see the composition of the next majority and the coalition coming up. Anastasia Krasnopolskaya is another activist from the Center for Combating Corruption. On Vakarchuk's list, we have again two very bright individuals, Alexandra Ustinova, who had just spent a year at Stanford on Ukraine Emerging Leaders Program, also from the Center for Combating Corruption. And of course, Yaroslav Yurchishin is number 8, Executive Director of Transparency International. But although, you know, these bright young individuals are present on the list, I would claim that they cannot they cannot be identified with real change in how politics will be done in Ukraine, because, you know, you cannot change much with only two people whom you put in the top 10 and who signal to the Ukrainian electorate, you know, that we are changing. Because to understand Zelensky's list, you have to look much deeper and see who is behind and who is influencing whom. Let me start with single mandate constituencies and give you just a little bit, some names to let you get a sense of how things look. So, for example, number 90, from a single mandate constituency, number 4, we have a guy on Zelensky's campaign, Nikita Paturayev, the guy who worked as a political consultant of Sergei Tigipka, Viktor Pinchuk, and Sergei Taruta. In Mykolaiv, we have Alexander Gaidu, the former staffer of Firtash's companies. In Kiev, a single mandate constituency, 229, we have a woman, Putova, who's via we don't know at all, a completely unknown person. She runs as a leader of an NGO that was registered, listen to the date, June 25, 2019. So basically a few days before the list was announced. Like if they take someone, present this person as a leader of civil society, and although no one knows who she was before, and etc. In Dnipro, central mandate constituency 24, we have Dmitro Kisilevsky, who used to work for Pinchuk and strongly linked to him. So you see that basically the names Taruta, Pinchuk, Tigitka, Firtash, all these people run as candidates of Zelensky, but not on party list, but from single mandate constituencies, and we understand how much money they will bring into the campaign. And if we also know that even before the start of campaign, any candidate who runs as Zelensky's representative automatically can count for 20% of vote, simply because people say that they will vote. They don't care about who this person is as long as he is Zelensky's candidate. Actually, this public attitude played a bad game with Zelensky, because the Central Election Commission later identified officially at least 10 candidates. Zelensky's lawyers now claim that they have counted more than 100 people who run as so-called clones of Zelensky. Clones. So they registered various companies, NGOs, philanthropic foundations, and all call them Sluha Narodu, servant of the people. So because a person who will elect his candidate from a single mandate constituency, imagine an old lady, 65, just, I don't know, still a young person here in the United States, in Ukraine, up to 35, you're already a retired person, you will look, Sluha Narodu, you will not even read between the lines whether this is a political party or whether this is a philanthropic foundation. You will just vote for this person. So based on this scheme and this fraudulent scheme, Zelensky's lawyers advised him to register a trademark. So Sluha Narodu is now a trademark. But nevertheless, some people are trying to find the way of how this can be manipulated and how they can also benefit of being associated with Sluha Narodu without actually being part of Zelensky's campaign. Kvartal 95 candidate. This is a hilarious case. In Dnipro, we have from a single mandate constituency, actor Yuzik. Last name Yuri Karyavchenkov. He is a member of Kvartal 95 and has been part of Zelensky's team since day one. In the single mandate constituency close to it, number 32, is Mrs. Krivoruchkina, who is a friend of Yuzik's wife, like their family buddies. And in single mandate constituency 31, we have Mr. Zakharchenko, who is a brother of Yuzik's mother. So this is somehow gives you an understanding how people were put on this ticket or from simple mandate constituency pretty randomly. Well, some journalists claim that there is even a Medvedchuk connection with Zelensky, because in Mykolaiv Oblast, Zelensky's headquarters, unfortunately you can see the, read the text, but Medvedchuk's political party headquarters and Zelensky's political party headquarters are registered at the same legal address. They're in the same building, in the same office, which is a pretty surprising thing. Mr. Kolodov Andrei, who is number 22 on Zelensky's ticket, is a long-term friend of Medvedchuk. Their children, their godmother is Medvedchuk's wife, and they have villa in Vienna worth 6 million euro. And again, this is this information came to surface because Ukraine's investigative journalists have been doing a very good job looking at who is who and who owns what, and looking at Facebook, Instagram, trying to find photographs that. Then on this photograph you can again see Alexander Tkachenko and this big bearded man named Andriy Vavrish. Here there are more photographs of him with Andriy Bogdan. You see they even smoke kalyan, they travel together. So he is also a business partner of Dmytro Isayenko, who runs on Medvedchuk's electoral ticket as number 15. He is the owner of a construction bureau that proposed to move presidential secretariat from Bankova Street to this Ukrainian house, former museum of Lenin in Kiev. And he is an associate of Dmytro Gurin and Anna Bonder, who run as also from this construction mafia, as I would call it, who run from Zelensky's candidate from Central Mandate constituencies in Kiev. Sergei Leshenko wrote on his Facebook page that this Andriy Vavrish is now basically responsible for all candidates who run from single mandate constituencies, and that he is the one who is kind of now the patron of Zelensky's campaign in the city of Kiev. Having mentioned Sergei Leshenko, I would like to show you his political campaign advertisement. You know, Leshenko, who was very close to Zelensky during the presidential election campaign and who supported him publicly and hoped to get on his electoral ticket, ended up not as part of his electoral ticket, and he runs as an independent candidate in Kiev from one of the single mandate constituencies in Podil. But he is using the colors of Zelensky's campaign, and he says, "I'm the true servant of the people." And he says in his statements that, again, he criticizes Zelensky. He says that Zelensky is simply being embraced by wrong guys, that Zelensky is promised something else, and he doesn't fully deliver on his promises. So he is now positions himself as someone who is not in very strong opposition to Zelensky, but who, as Sergei Inosenko said in his comments, started questioning, you know, how the country will operate under Zelensky's management. This is a hilarious story too. We have a TV anchor, Alexander Skichko, a very handsome young man who was an anchor when Ukraine hosted Eurovision. Beautiful English, it was a pleasure watching him on camera. He runs as a single mandate constituency in Cherkasy. But although we have nothing bad to say about Alexander Skichko personally, when we look at his family ties, we will understand that his father, he is married to a daughter of a very wealthy man. He's not an oligarch, but he is very close to being an oligarch. This is a Ukrainian businessman, Leonid Yurushev, who owns Intercontinental Kiev Hotel in Kiev, Fairmont Grand Hotel in Kiev, several very kind of big companies, and he also owns Business Center Leonardo, former co-owner of Forum Bank. So you understand that these are people with money, and when you ask yourself, could this Alexander Skichko, okay, he has an experience with television, with show business, what kind of a politician can he be? So why someone like him and not another Stanford participant of Emerging Ukraine Leaders Program instead of him? Well, here is the answer. You know, he has a wealthy father-in-law who probably buy his place on Zelensky's campaign. This is another wonderful example of a guy who used to run from Petro Poroshenko's bloc Solidarity during the previous election campaign, and now this Pavlo Pavlish all of a sudden becomes a candidate from Zelensky. So you see that these people, they basically have no ideology and no affiliation, they have nothing that they stand for. They could be with Poroshenko 5 years ago, now they're with Zelensky. A lot of opportunists who are just finding the way of how to get into Ukraine's political life. Yes, this is Irina Barzova. She runs from Vinnytsia, and her husband, Sergei Barzov, was chief of Poroshenko's state management directorate, a guy who was implicated in a lot of corruption scandals, the girl who owns restaurants in Crimea, and whose father is again a former business partner of Zelensky and who managed the League of Humor with him. The naked girl on the right, on the left, was number 73 on Zelensky's list. When these photographs of her in nightclubs and Instagram photos with a lot of cocktail drinks and nightclubs in Kyiv had been revealed, Zelensky made the right decision and took her off. But it also shows you, you know, what kind of selection they had initially during the first days of campaign. And this guy, Roman Fedunyak, someone made a Facebook post saying, oh, look, this is a former student of mine, Chuk, and about others. Why I'm so concerned about this campaign personally, because it demonstrates a complete the Ukraine's politics turns into a show business a little bit, and this is really worrisome. What I will say now has nothing to do with these photographs of Vakarchuk and Friedman, though we can talk a little bit about it too. But we can see now that Vakarchuk and Zelensky and also other political parties, they follow the same pattern. They think that if they organize concerts in different big cities in Ukraine with just a little bit of political campaigning in between, they will somehow agitate the electorate and let them follow them. Kvartal 95 has organized a tour. They will visit now 19 cities, and the last date of their tour will be July 19th. So you understand that this is fully related to Zelensky's campaign. The same applies to Vakarchuk, who travels mostly in Western Ukraine, but makes some reach out trips to Eastern Ukraine. It's also concerts. There is an agrarian party of Ukraine. They recently had this guy, what's his name, Oleg Vinnik. He is another pop star in Ukraine. Again, no experience in politics, but the leader of the party is a rector of the Ukrainian University of Culture and Art. So together with Vinnik, they start traveling all over Ukraine, also organizing all sorts of concerts. So in other words, you know, they believe, and I believe that Zelensky is a, you know, the first person to be blamed for this downgrading of Ukraine's politics in general. You know, the level of debate, intellectual debate, has been significantly decreased with this new wave of very populistic, almost showbiz kind of political life. Another two showmen, Kroliki, who ran supporters of Yelena Bondarenko's political campaign, etc. So probably we can now switch to Q&As. I gave you enough information, and we can talk about the composition of the coalition, etc., etc.